So let me thank the organizers of this meeting for giving me an opportunity to present my work here. So today I'm going to talk about some non-equilibrium dynamics that occur when you have a quasi-periodicity in the Hamiltonian, in a quantum Hamiltonian. So with quasi-periodicity, what I mean is if one of the terms in the Hamiltonian has a periodic, kind of periodic dependence like cosine of 2 pi beta j, where j is this lattice site, and provided beta is an irrational number, the Hamiltonian shows some very peculiar behavior. And what happens to the non-equilibrium dynamics of such a Hamiltonian when you drive it, either suddenly or slowly in some fashion? So my focus here would be a sudden change to the Hamiltonian when you have a quasi-periodic term in. So for example, the first example that I'm taking is this Aubrey-André model, which is a well-studied model, and it's a spin half XX chain in presence of this position-dependent transverse field. And as I mentioned before, the transverse field is site-dependent, and the dependence has this quasi-periodic term, this h cos 2 pi beta n. And if beta is an irrational number, then it can be shown that there is a transition from a completely delocalized eigenstate, which happens when h is smaller than this j, to a completely localized state. So all the eigenstates of the Hamiltonian, this particular Hamiltonian, with beta being irrational number, all the eigenstates of this Hamiltonian when h is less than j are extended or delocalized. Whereas for h greater than j, these all the eigenstates are localized. And so the advantage of this Hamiltonian, or why people got interested in studying this Hamiltonian, is this is a Hamiltonian which has a spatial dependence intermediate between a periodic and disordered. Or so people know that for a disordered system, you cannot have extended states for any dimensions less than 3. On the other hand, in this particular Hamiltonian, you do have a delocalized state even in one dimensions. And hence, one can study this localization-delocalization transition even in one dimension. So in the localized phase, which happens at when the magnitude of h is greater than j, the states have this exponential dependence where the xi, so-called the localization length of this state, eigenstate, goes as 1 by log of h by j. So it diverges when h is equal to j, which is the critical point of this Hamiltonian. So now let's talk about this is all about the equilibrium properties. So let's talk about the non-equilibrium dynamics which happens. So what I'm going to do in this particular example is, let's say you start from a state of h is equal to 0 and you quench it to some finite value h naught. Depending upon where this h naught is, you might end up in a delocalized phase or a localized phase. So the quantity that we are going to study, the evolution of entanglement entropy, is what we are going to study to monitor the transition from localized to delocalized phase. So what we do is, let's say you calculate the entanglement entropy of a subsystem A, which consists of a small set of L sites out of the total capital L sites, let's say. So as usual, we trace out all the sites which are not there in subsystem A and study or see what happens to the entanglement entropy as a function of time. So before commenting on what happens in this Aubrey-André model, what is already known is that if your system is homogeneous, so for example, if it's just a transversizing model or where the states are extended eigenstates or delocalized states, what is seen is that for the entanglement entropy, after such a sudden quench that I'm talking about, it increases linearly with time up to some time, and then after that, it saturates to a value, some constant value. On the other hand, in a random case or disordered case where you have a localized eigenstate, it is found that the entanglement entropy actually saturates to, immediately saturates to some finite value. And on the critical point, on the other hand, in at critical point, you have an extremely slow dynamics of this entanglement entropy. So in this Aubryant model, we know that we have phase when H is less than J, you have this eigenstates which are completely delocalized. That is, so we expect that if you quench it to a delocalized phase, then your system behaves similar to a homogeneous system. And we do expect that when you quench your Aubryant model to a field value of 0.5, then the entanglement entropy increases linearly, just like in the homogeneous case. On the other hand, if you quench it to the localized phase, we see that the entanglement entropy saturates. There is no linear behavior or there is no increase. And something special happens when you quench it to the critical phase of this model. And so it is not going linearly with time, but what we observe is that when you quench it to the critical point, that is when H is equal to 1, the entanglement entropy increases at T to the power sigma with a value that we obtain, with the obtained value equal to 0.43. So then we ask this question that can we explain this exponent 0.43? We attempted explaining this exponent using the picture of quasi-particles which propagate in your lattice after quenching, because initially your system starts from the ground state corresponding to the initial Hamiltonian, and when you quench it, your state is now in an excited state, and hence it will produce quasi-particles. So this has been very well developed in case of a homogeneous system. These quasi-particles propagate in the system, and then looking at so for example, if you want to, so the quasi-particle interpretation, the homogeneous case would be that your initial state, which now has become an eigenstate, has become a source of quasi-particles, and a pair of quasi-particles which are produced randomly at sites will propagate in the system. And how do I calculate the entanglement entropy? That so the two subsystems A and B will be entangled if a pair, one of the quasi-particles of a pair is in A and the other is in B. And but in this particular case, how we looked at is, we basically looked at how the, if you have a wave packet, we borrowed basically the calculation which is done for quasi-crystals, the transport of electrons in quasi-crystals. So there what people do is you put a wave packet at a site and you look at how this wave packet spreads with time. So if we do the same analysis here, we actually can see that if your system is in, so basically what happens to a spreading of wave packet if you are in the homogeneous case, we see that it goes linearly with time. On the other hand, if you are in the critical phase, then you get an exponent which is of the order of 0.44. So using wave packet spreading, we could explain these exponents that we get. The second example, which is actually what I wanted to speak here, but I couldn't complete the work. So it is basically the transversizing model, where the transverse field has this this spatial dependence. This cannot be exactly solved. In the Aubryant model, there is this, it is self-dual at H is equal to J. So people could comment about the criticality. On the other hand, here, it's not exactly solved. But at the same time, the phase diagram of this model is much more rich. You have in the phase diagram phases where there is low-lying states are extended, whereas the higher states are localized. So there's this mobility edge in the system in such one-dimensional Hamiltonian. And my aim is to actually study how this presence of mobility edge, whether it's going to affect the non-equilibrium dynamics at all. So with this, I'm concluding my talk here. So basically, sudden quench dynamics of Aubryant model shows clear characteristics of localized and delocalized phases, which we studied using the evolution of entanglement entropy, and the next is still yet to be done in the process. Thank you.
Questions? Just
the Aubrey-Henry model, isn't the wave packet spread around square root of t?
At the critical point, it is close to
square root of t, at least more or less.
Correct.
But you have 0.4.
0.45. In numerics also, we calculated it came out to be 0.45 if we do. So you have, we looked at these calculations using three fermion pictures. So you use these eigenstates phi n of.
So you're saying that spread of the wave packet exponent is basically what you would expect for your entanglement entropy.
This is how the wave packet, the quasi particles are basically wave packets, and how they spread in time should be reflected here is what we believe.
When you switch on the disorder, why?
You mean quasi periodic?
Yes.
Uh-huh.
Why is it that the quasi particles are produced in pairs?
So in homogeneous case, we can explain that they occur in pairs.
But now once you have disorder, there is no momentum conservation.
There's no momentum conservation, so I'm not introducing any momentum here. Only thing is that there are these wave packets which are produced and they are traveling. So that explanation was for homogeneous case. They are produced in pairs, and you say that one is entangled with the other side if one of them is here and the other side. And we just extended that analogy here.
More questions? Then let us thank the speaker.